Welcome back to another creative exploration with me, Tammy Collins. I have such a special creative exploration today, and here's a sneak peek at what we're going to be doing. So it's my oldest son's birthday coming up this weekend, and I wanted to make him a card, and then I just didn't feel great about that, so I decided to make him a birthday art piece instead. And so I just ran with that idea. It wasn't on the agenda. It just sort of overcame me in the moment to do it. And so I thought I'd record it and share it with you as a special tribute to him and his birthday. His name is Max. And so I'm starting with this letter M that actually was inspired by another piece that I will show you a glimpse of in a minute. And I thought, let's just start with that. I didn't think about this ahead of time, so this is raw in the moment, pure, just inspirational, intuitive creation. And that's what I really love to do the most. Right now I'm tracing over the M with a Posca marker because I wanted to kind of be visible through. I'm going to put a tissue paper layer on top of it, and I want the M to be visible through that. I could have did that after. Maybe I will, but at this point, this is where I'm at and what I'm doing. There's some water, and I'm getting out some glue. I'm just getting a rough sizing. I'm going to cut off some of the bulk of it. And forgive me if this looks a little bit cluttered, but as I've mentioned before, I live in a tiny house. I live in 300 square feet, and my art studio is the size of this creation space that you see, which is literally a canvas. I work on a lot of wood canvases. It's literally a wood canvas that we made the desktop. It's, so it's like 27 inches by 32 or something along those lines. So right now I'm just creating some freehand shapes that I want, again, to be visible through the tissue paper as sort of a underneath layer. And so I'm just getting ready here with a towel. I'm really crumpling up this paper. I really want it to have a lot of lines and textures and creases and lots of goodies. My oldest son, Max, he's my mini me. He is also a creative powerhouse. He's a director of photography. He makes movies, he makes films, he does a lot of crazy things, and I really can't believe that he is turning 27. My goodness, I'm really feeling old. He's just an amazing person, very genuine, and he's really talented. He's very smart. He's been blessed to work on a lot of great projects already. So I'm just applying the tissue paper here. I'm using this glazing medium that I've been using the last few days because it's all I have on hand right now. You may have seen in other videos, I live very remote, so it's not like I can run out and grab supplies, so I try to do those trips all at once and get everything I need, or do a big order and that kind of thing online. I just haven't gotten around to doing it yet. I've been busy focusing on getting my creative process or my creative time recorded, and it's going pretty well. So I let that dry, and now I'm just, I want to crease or cut this tissue paper at the tape line. It's probably not going to come off. That's not my intent. I just want to make sure that it's cut so that when I'm completed with the piece that it will separate when the tape separates. So when I pull the tape back, I just want the tissue paper to already be cut and come along with it, and I don't have to worry about trying to cut it in the end. I found that this is very helpful because the longer something dries and gets more solidified, it's harder and harder to get it apart. And as you may have seen or experienced already, pulling tape off paper isn't always the easiest of tasks. It tends to rip the paper and all kinds of crazy stuff. So anything I can do to help it is important. Okay, so a couple of things I'm going to be doing a little bit new as I'm doing these recording these sessions. I'm learning some things that I could improve on or do better. So I hope you bear with me and learn from my mistakes. As you can see, I'm doing a little swatching here. Yes, I know I don't have my beautiful swatch book out, but I'm pulling some colors. I have a palette in mind for him that when I think of him, I just thought of these colors. You know, and the meaning behind them, and they just suit him very well. But a couple things. At the end of the videos now, I'm going to be showing a color palette swatch based on the piece that I did. And I will also show all of the mediums and tools that I used at the end of the video. So hang around to the end and you'll be able to see those. And I thought it would be really great. I know a lot of people really love the. Oh, there's the. This is an iPhone holder that my husband made out of cedar. And I decided to put the M on there. And when I did that is when I got inspired to make this birthday art instead of a birthday card. And so I lost my train of thought. Sorry. I know that a lot of people get stuck on color or where to start, or, you know, it can be a strong barrier. I like to call it the blank page problem. You know, what colors do I pick? What do I start with? And how do I get inspiration? So that's why we watch all these videos, right? We learn things, we want to figure them out. So I thought it would be really great to just take the piece that I made and use the piece as the color inspiration for you. So you can, if you really like it and you really like what I created, you can grab that card and have it for you to be inspired to make a piece yourself. And if you would like that, just let me know in the comments and I will be happy to get that over to you. I would recommend telling me that you would like it and then going on over to the description box and filling out the Your Creativity Matters with your email so that I know how to get you that swatch. And I'll send it to you in a PNG form and you can just print that out or honestly just leave it on your iPad or your iPhone and you can use it right there. Of course, when you print things, you're going to get a little bit different color palette, which is normal. And again, it doesn't have to be hyper specific as long as you're within the family of colors, if that makes sense. So what I did was is I colored in the M's with the brown Posca marker, and now I'm using my beloved Tombow markers, and I'm just adding a little bit of color and washing it out with a little bit of water to spread it around and get some color on here. You know, I probably could have did that part first. I don't know. I'm just going with what is speaking to me. This is a completely intuitive piece. And I think you'll see that as it evolves here. I just want this textured paper in the background to look really old and aged and worn. And that'll happen because you'll see here I'm going to rip it. As always, I'm impatient, but so I'm just getting in some color. I want it to look aged, so I added in some of this brown, and I'm just sort of blending in some of the areas a little bit more, making them look a little more aged. I don't want the color to be so specific. So now I'm just gonna kind of outline these shapes. You know, remember, I don't really have a plan, so I'm just going with what I want to do next. So this is the charcoal pencil. I'm just doing in some ra- Oh, see, there it is. I ripped it, of course. I'm so impatient. Notice the tapping on the table. I get so frustrated with myself because I know that I'm super impatient and I should be waiting a little bit longer. But that's not how I like to create. So I run with it. I'm just going to put a little bit of more of the medium on here. I'm going to take a few scraps of tissue paper and just kind of cover up that spot. It's just going to lend to the effect that I was trying to get in the first place. And once it's on here, you'll notice you won't even be able to tell where that was. I'm so proud of, I have two boys. I'm so proud of them both. I really spent a lot of time in their childhood really trying to impress upon them the importance and the power of following what your passion is and what you feel called to do, what makes you happy. I really drove that home, and they have both done that, and it's really a great thing to watch and see them do that. So now I'm just taking in a dark navy and coloring in these orbs or shapes. They look like rocks or meteors is maybe what I was maybe a little more thinking of. I kind of got a little carried away with that at first, and then I'm like, oh, wait a second, maybe that's not how I want to do that. And as I did more of them, I got a little bit more clear on how I wanted to color these in. But that's okay. Oh, I am going to. Okay, so we're continuing on with these orbs, asteroids, meteors, rocks. And see here now, I kind of figured out how I wanted those to look. I'm just kind of re-accentuating the shape with some random lines around it. Okay, so now I'm going to put some more lines in. I use my non-dominant hand. This is my left hand, and I'm right-handed, and as I want them to be uncontrolled and free-flowing, just more of naturally what wants to happen. And now I'm just using the Tombow marker and kind of going over those a little bit. It's an interesting effect when the charcoal and the water-based Tombow interact. It creates a neat look. And just filling in a few spots that are showing through. So now I'm going over the brown with the brown Posca marker with a brown Tombow because I want the letters to look aged, and so all the crinkles that were existing from the tissue paper are getting highlighted now by the Tombow. So I'm just using the side and just trying to hit the surface of those creases. So it suddenly makes that look more like leather. And then I'm just coming back and giving it a little bit of a shadow so that the letters pop out a little bit more. I just thought it would be really neat to do a birthday art instead of a birthday card. something neat that I can start for my kids. You know, they're older now and appreciate, things like art and music and that sort of thing. Just think it has a little bit more meaning. It might feel a little more special, and they can maybe have a little collection of these over the years. And thankfully, I'm recording this process now, so I'll be able to look back and remember what it was I created and make sure that they're different and special. So now I'm doing a gel pen line. It's ever so subtle. It looks like really slight veining. And what I want to do is kind of come in underneath the meteors or rocks and do sort of that cobblestone effect. And I'm going to skip forward a little bit here because I don't want you to get too bored with the technique. But you can see, well, my hand's in the way, but you can kind of see the technique. You've seen me do this before. I'm creating almost like smaller meteors or cobblestones or rocks, whatever you want to call them. And so there you can see I'm finishing it up on the other side. So both of those sections where those rocks or asteroids are have now sort of a connected cobblestone effect underneath. And then I'm going to take the fine Posca marker and come back and heavily stipple in those shapes. And again, I'll skip forward so you can see the end result without the long process. But you can see here I'm just doing stippling in there. And this acts as like a shadowing. It helps to really accentuate and pull out the shape, the asteroid shapes. So I'm sort of just waiting for a calling here of what I'm supposed to do. I really want to put some white in there, but I'm not quite ready yet. So I'm noticing that the blue doesn't feel opaque. So I'm going over it in a different direction. So it's almost like a cross hatching. So I originally went colored in mostly vertical. Now I'm coming in sort of horizontal, and that'll help fill in any of those high spots that got missed. It's just going to really solidify that color a little bit. And then it occurs to me that, these are supposed to feel like rocks or asteroids or meteors or some sort of rough material that maybe I should come back in with the blue, just like I did on the brown, and hit the high spots and really kind of accentuate those and give them more of a texturized feel or the illusion of texture. And this works wonderfully. It does the same sort of thing that the brown did to the letter. The letter looks like leather, and now these look more like they could be rocks. So I'm just kind of taking a light gray here and kind of giving the rocks a shadow in between. So I sort of have those loose shapes on top of the rocks that almost look like they could be behind the rock now, and I'm just giving them a bit of a shadow to add some depth to them, which will help these to look more three-dimensional as opposed to just being flat on the paper. So I'm also realizing that I want to go over that long, those additional charcoal lines again. I just really want them to feel almost like a shadow on the line, if you will. If you notice, I'm placing it in a certain spot as if the light were coming from a particular side. And later you'll see because I'll add white, which will help to accentuate that. So I'm just going to take black and then really highlight that line. I really like it. I want it to pop out a little more. So I'm just kind of really loosely and roughly going over that. hope you're not hearing that noise. So I live above a river here, and so on a mountain, and there's sort of like a holler, and across the river on the other side is a beautiful farming field, and I guess they're preparing the field or doing something over there, and they just started some equipment. So I hope that isn't too distracting. It's a beautiful day here. It's almost 80 degrees, so I have the window open, letting some fresh air in. But because it's sort of a holler, sometimes it can echo a little, like it sounds a little bit louder than it is. It's pretty far away. I'd have to get the binoculars out to see what's going on over there. But so now I'm just doing a little bit more shadow work around the stones. I came back and sort of did another line around them. I added some dark shadow to the bottom left of the rock or the orb so that it appears to have a shaded side, and then I'm adding some highlights in on the other side now. I really want those to feel more three-dimensional. And you can see I really want to add more white here. And so now I'm going to outline the M like I did on the iPhone block that my husband made, just because I wanted to feel a little coordinated. That was the inspiration for what I'm doing. So I'm using this blue metallic. I love this blue metallic with the brown. You know, if you really get into color theory, there's some amazing meanings behind the emotions that are evoked behind colors. And I just think that people exude colors. You know, brown is considered to be or give the illusion or feeling or emotion or evoke stability and reliability, which is so ironic because this is literally my son, Max. It's dependable and comforting. It's a great counselor and a friend full of wisdom. You know, you can count on their help, their honest opinion, they're supportive and protective, they're stabilizing. I mean, all of these things are just the epitome of my son. And then, you know, if you do blue, you know, you're going to get the same sort of complement, really, because blue is the color of trust and loyalty, and it's calming and relaxing, and you can see how that's just such a beautiful match to the brown. And if you knew him, you would go, oh, yes, it's so obvious. Blue makes us feel confident and secure. It doesn't like confrontation or too much attention. It's honest and reliable. So I'm just coming back in now, and I'm hitting those lines with the white where I want it to feel like those veins, if you will, or those cracks are also dimensional. And so I'm also coming in now with a little bit of sort of scribble around the cobblestone effect with the stippling, just to give it a little bit more depth and interest. And so I'm going to pause it, and of course I'll come back to it when it's finished. But I'm really loving this piece, and so don't forget to stick around till the end. Please be sure to like and share your thoughts on the piece, and make sure you're subscribed and you hit the bell notification. And if you would really like to get a color inspiration tool based on this particular piece, be sure to hang around till the end. You can sign up, give me your email with your Creativity Matters link in my description box, and drop in the comments that you'd love to get this color card. And at the end of the video, I'll be sure to make sure I show all of the tools that I used. It's something that I noticed that I haven't been doing. I'm terrible with coming back and writing it in the description. So I thought, well, what better way to just show you right in the video? So if you just hang around to the end, you'll get to see the pieces. It's fresh in my mind. They're right here, present, so they won't get overlooked or forgotten. And as you know, I love to just come back and give it a crisp black line. It really just makes the piece pop. I did this particular piece on this same 140-pound mixed media paper that I got from Hobby Lobby. I think it's actually the Master's Touch brand. I'm not super impressed with this paper, but it's affordable and it's a great piece, great paper to do experiments with. And there it is. There's the finished piece. Okay, so now we're just going to go through and look at all the colors, and you have the navy, the brown, the metallic blue, black, white, a couple different sizes, the gel Sharpie pen, the charcoal pencil, the Tombow, and a couple different shades of blues and browns and grays. And that's, I also use this glazing medium to stick the tissue paper down. But I hope you enjoyed this video. Please tell me your thoughts. There's the finished piece. Be sure to like, subscribe. And there's the palette inspired by this piece. If you'd like to get that, be sure to let me know in the comments. I'll see you next time on the next creative exploration.